Amen. Amen. What a powerful time we've had already in worship. It's one of my favorite things to do. I love to sit back, stand in the back, and just watch and pray and ask God what He's doing and catching and being in tune with the Holy Spirit. And I'm grateful for people who are led by the Spirit. And I'm grateful for a Spirit that shows up in a room designated for Him. Amen. Okay. I'm so thankful for that. I'm so grateful for that. Yesterday was an amazing, absolutely amazing day. Absolutely amazing. We have a visiting pastor and his wife from Michigan, and this was one of their first. That was Michigan, I think. They weren't cheering for you; they were cheering for Michigan. That's all right. Ohio State is coming. And so you can be quiet too. And so we are so excited about what happened yesterday. Probably the most powerful and prolific thing that took place was watching children and teenagers serve. The visiting pastors from Michigan that were with us this weekend, we were sitting at the couch at my house after it was all over with, and Pastor Lonnie said to me, he said, all I could keep thinking all day long was, this is real ministry. This is real ministry. What we do here, the insinuation of the statement that he made was that what happens outside of the walls is really where real ministry takes place. If you came to church today to experience the ministry, you have missed the point of ministry. For he told us to go into all the world. And did you know that all the world ain't in here yet? And the reason why they ain't in here yet is because we're so busy running around acting crazy in here that we don't let our light so shine before men that they would see our good works and give glory to God our Father. You understand what I'm saying? And so yesterday was real ministry. And my heart is full this morning because 19 people came to the kingdom. To the kingdom. And it was done by children. And it was done by teenagers. And it was done by adults. And it was done by people who were single. And married couples came together. And couples with children and couples that do not have children. And do you understand what I'm saying? And there was red and yellow and black and white and polka dotted and candy striped people that were ministering across and abroad. Listen, your life is way too important to live for yourself. You understand what I'm saying? It's way too important to live for yourself. And this, if he came to seek and save that which was lost, don't you think the agenda of us as the body of Christ is to do the same? You see, God has a vision for our lives. It's just a determination of whether we're going to follow his vision or we're going to do our own thing. And I'm so grateful. But you don't understand, in the past 2 weeks, there are over 50 people that have come to the kingdom in 2 weeks because of the ministry. Over 50. Over 50. Over 50. Ooh. Next week, with everything within Pastor Michael and the team, the staff and I, we've been sitting brainstorming for multiple hours. How do I let you know what's going on? The goal of 2000, from September of 2015 to 2016, is that God helps us to win 1,000 people to the kingdom. Now, if you expect that to happen on a Sunday morning, you miss the point of being in the kingdom. He didn't call us to the castle. He called us to the kingdom. For it is the kingdom that suffers violence, but the violent. We're asking audacious prayers for 1,000 people to come to. That means somebody's going to have to be one in your cubicle. That means some. You understand what I'm saying? We can't limit it to an hour and a half, an hour and 45 minutes on Sunday morning. That I have to believe that everywhere you go, it is an assignment to advance the kingdom of heaven. And I want you to be a part of that. And so next week, with everything within us, next week, you're going to begin to see. The goal is 1,000 representations of people that have come to the kingdom. And it is my prayer that by the end of these next few months, by the time we get to September 2016, there is 1,000, I'm not going to tell you what it is yet. Oh, I'll tell you. Can I tell you? You want me to tell you? We're buying crowns. We're buying crowns. And every crown is going to represent a soul. And we are going to display the crowns because those are the crowns that they were no longer an orphan, but they became the sons of God, the King. But that same crown that they have put on as a son, they're one day going to lay before the... You understand? The feet of the master. They're gonna. So you're gonna. I'm telling you, before this thing's over with, I'm declaring 1,000 crowns being laid out all over this place. No, that's so wrong. And laid out all over the facility that God is going to give us. You understand what I'm saying? I just believe that with all my heart. Believe that with all my heart. Let's get into audacious prayers. I need to hush. I'm full this morning. I'm full. Audacious prayers. We are in a series entitled Audacious Prayers. Those people who understand that you and I have to move beyond this plastic conversation we have with God and ask Him for things that are in our ability to do if we would just be a little more disciplined. But what are those things in your spirit, in your heart, that your eye has not seen and your ear has not heard and it has never even entered into your heart of what God has for you? You and I begin to tap into the place where we audaciously ask and come boldly before the throne of grace. Audacious, bold, risky prayers. Where are those things that if God doesn't do it, that it's not going to get done kind of prayers? That is so audacious, is so crazy, is so ridiculous. Not in myself, but He has put it in my spirit and in my heart to desire it. You understand what I'm saying? Those kinds of things. That when He does do it, the only way you can do in recognition of what has happened is to go, that had to have been the Lord. You know what I'm saying? That it had to have been God. You're not good enough. You're not smart enough. You're not talented enough. You don't have the right Rolodex. You don't have enough context. You don't know the right things to manipulate people that because you know that God has to manipulate this situation. You understand what I'm saying? That when all of it comes to the brass tacks and the end result, you realize and you go, God did that. Ain't no man going to get credit for what has happened in my life. When's the last time you prayed on that level? The master taught us in Luke chapter number 11, the disciples that were with him said, Lord, teach us to pray on this level. Because what happens when you get alone with God, there is a demonstration that takes place publicly. And we've recognized the secret by private prayer produces public power. We want to know the public power because of the private prayer. That the private prayer is what has produced it. I want to know it. We find it in Matthew chapter number 6. We're going to James 1 today. So if you're turning in your Bible, we're going to James 1. But I want to help us all understand in Matthew chapter number 6. He said, Lord, teach us to pray. He said, pray according to this pattern. This is not a poem. This is a pattern. These are principles that God is giving us. He says, pray like this. Say it with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Today, we are going to deal with lead us not into temptation. Lead us not into temptation. Now, I got to be very transparent with you today. All of my life, when I have really understood how to pray, not this poem, but this pattern, this statement has been really confusing to me. This statement makes no sense to me at all. Lead me not. If you're the great God who is working all things together for my good, you're the great God who every good and perfect gift comes from you. Why would you tell me to ask you not to lead me into temptation? If you're the God who is leading me even through the valley of the shadow of death, then to the point, to the place where I don't even have to fear any evil, because I know your rod and your staff is comforting me, and you're preparing a table before me in the presence of my enemy, and you're anointing my head with oil, and my cup is running over, and I know that surely goodness and mercy is following me all the days of my life. I understand all of that. Why do I need to pray, lead me not into temptation? Why would I even have to declare for you not to lead me into temptation? I shouldn't have to tell God, don't put me in that situation. This has been very confusing to me for years until I got to this series. I got the secret sauce. Lead me not into temptation. One of the things you need to understand when you study the Word of God, anything in the Bible you don't understand is because you don't understand it. Oh, we in the slow class this morning. Hallelujah. Anything. Do you hear the words that are coming out of my mouth? Anything that you don't understand in the Bible is because you don't understand. Here's what I mean by that. There's nothing wrong with the book. And just because we cannot grasp it, it is not a determination of what's wrong with the book, but our minds have not been renewed, therefore we have not been transformed. So instead of confronting a text that you cannot comprehend, look at that and go, Holy Spirit, you live on the inside of me, and oh, by the way, you're the author of the book. Unveil to me this principle that I cannot grasp in myself. Anything in the Bible you don't understand is because you don't understand it. Lead us not into temptation. Go with me to the book of James. James chapter number 1, temptation. 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 We'll start with verse number 12. Blessed is the man who endures temptation. What? For when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. The reason why you and I enter into temptation is because there is a blessing and a reward on the other side of it. You see the text? Blessed is the man. That word endure means this. It means to continue to trust through resistance and opposition. There is a blessing and a reward for me when I continue to trust through resistance and through opposition. He's not telling me to only trust when there is no resistance and when there is no opposition. He's telling me that when I experience resistance and I experience opposition, the blessing and the reward is when I endure it, not avoid it. Oh, this is so good, man. Let no one, verse 13, let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then, when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings death. He is saying to me and to you that when temptation comes, temptation is there for you and I to experience the ability to learn how to endure, not avoid. And when you and I learn the secret of endurance, see, we don't want to work at nothing no more. We don't want to work at our marriage. Oh, God. You understand? We don't want to work at our job. They paying you $25 an hour and you... I'm going to let everybody in on a secret. There is nobody in this room that gets paid what they deserve. But you could get less than what you get. My God, for everything I do, they ought to be. Yeah. But the reason why God hasn't prospered you on that level is because he can't trust you with what you got. You're trying to serve Job Jireh, not Jehovah. Ain't getting no amens today. Temptation. Audacious prayer point number one. I want you to understand, temptation is not sin. For Jesus was tempted in every way, yet without sin. So I want you to understand that when temptation comes into your life, that does not mean sin is there. It means that you have been placed into a situation where you are being tried, where you are being tested, where God is allowing you an opposition and some resistance to create more endurance. Then you, listen, those of you that work out, those of you that want to work out, those of you like me that think about working out, hoping that that helps. Okay? In your mind, I mean, lifting that fork in the name of Jesus, lift that bicep. The bigger the scoop, the more I'm working that bicep. You understand what I'm saying? You've got to recognize that he allows those things to come because it's building muscle that you would not use if you didn't have. It's all about resistance training. Because we wouldn't do nothing if we didn't get fat. But the problem is we've become so spiritually fat happy. We sit on our blessed assurance. I got kids in here. You understand what I'm saying? And we want to wait till the sweet and by for the good old gospel ship to come rescue us. The devil is a lie. So he brings opposition and resistance into our life so you and I can recognize, wait a minute, there's something that I'm going towards. There's something that I'm trying to achieve. There is a purpose behind my pain, and there is a process that I got to go through to be able to hold that promise. And he does it through resistance. But temptation is not sin. Because you're tempted to quit doesn't mean you've sinned. It's when you quit. That's where we've got separation. It's not when you... My wife is sitting there. Do you know how many times she must have been tempted to stab me in the middle of the night? I mean, think about what that woman has had to endure. There is a great promise on the other side of this opposition. And it ain't no other man. You understand what I'm saying? Hallelujah. You imagine? I bet she dreams in certain moments. Oh, I stab him right in the neck. Pull his heart out with a spoon. You understand what I'm saying? It's dull, so it'll be hard. Never mind. You understand what I'm saying? But I got wives going, I understand exactly what you mean. Yeah, well, you ain't all that cracked up to be either, homie. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So, but it is this, there's nothing wrong with that. But when I begin to entertain it, I begin to premeditate how it takes place. Temptation is not sin. Yet most of us carry guilt from the temptation that we've never acted on. Your enemy, your adversary, the devil, the one they call the tempter, he only has three strategies that he deals with. It is the lust of the flesh, it is the lust of the eyes, and it is the pride of life. We saw it in the garden from the very beginning. We find this in 1 John chapter 5, I believe it is. But we find it again in the garden. This is where it started at the very beginning with Eve. She comes in and she's looking for food. It is the desire of her flesh to be nourished. So the serpent comes up to the tree and goes, look, Eve, look how good this fruit is. And all of a sudden she lays her eyes on what it is. And now she is desiring something that she has been commanded not to touch. So the lust of the flesh has now become the lust of the eyes. And she saw, the Bible, and she saw that it was good for food. And then he goes to the next step and says, did God say that if you eat of this tree, you'll surely die? No, 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 no. The problem is, if you eat of this tree, you're going to be like God, and now the pride of life shows up. Well, wait a minute. If I can think like God, talk like God, act like God, then I might as well go. This is the hooks that Satan uses. It was the lust of the flesh that produced the lust of the eyes that eventually went to the pride of life. We see it in the wilderness when Jesus was drove into the wilderness in Matthew chapter number 4. He comes in and Satan, he's in the wilderness and he's in a fast for 40 days. And the first thing Satan says to him is, look, why don't you turn this stone into bread, the lust of the flesh? I'm hungry, I'm in a fast, the lust of the flesh, turn it into bread. Feed that lust. And then he says, look, I want you to see the kingdoms. that I can give you control of. If you'll just worship and bow down to me, all of a sudden he begins to see the opportunity. It's the lust of the eyes that Satan is trying to use. And then he tells him, look, you don't even have to do all that, but if you'll just bow down and worship me, I'll make you in charge of all the kingdoms, and I'll bring the angels to come in and take care of you. You don't have to endure this. You don't have to go through this problem. Oh my goodness, it's the pride of life all over again. Did you know Satan only comes after you in three ways? It's the lust of your flesh, it's the lust of what you see, and it is the pride of I deserve better than this. Pride cometh before. Temptation is not sin. Audacious prayer point number two. God can't tempt us. I want you to understand, God can't tempt you. We heard it in James chapter 1. I encourage you to read the entire chapter. It's amazing. I don't have time. The whole book of James is amazing. But James chapter 1 really helps us with this temptation thing. He says to us, he says, do not say, I did this. The Lord brought me into the Lord. There's two people we get a whole lot of credit for that had nothing to do with a lot of things. God and the devil. We give the devil a lot more credit than he deserves. He's sitting there going, I didn't have nothing to do with that. I mean, I'll take it. That was all on you. It was your own desire. God cannot tempt us. Listen to Matthew chapter 4, verse 3. Now when the tempter came to him, speaking of Jesus, he said, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to turn. The tempter. That word tempter means seducer. The seducer came to him. The Spirit of God drove him into the wilderness to be in a trial. But then the seducer came into the wilderness experience to... When Samson fell in love with Delilah, the problem was he set himself up by his own desires when he's sleeping with hookers. So he's in the bed of prostitutes, still anointed, going and killing Philistines into purpose, but it set him up with a desire on the inside of him that the enemy brought in Delilah to set him up for failure. The word Delilah means a seductive call. Oh God, I don't even say it in my notes. It's a seductive call. She came from the valley, which is a place that is beneath him. She was a seductive call lower than where he was. She was a seductive call from beneath him to bring him down. She was from the valley of Sorek. She was a seductive call from the valley of Sorek. That word Sorek translates a place of destruction. She was seductively calling him down to be destroyed. I feel the Holy Ghost. She was being used. She was the tempter. She was the seductive call down from where he was. I just want you to know that people that are beneath you are beneath you.
Come on.
She tried to call him down to the tempter. The tempter came into the wilderness experience in Jesus' life to try to seduce him. I may be in a trial, but that doesn't mean God is seducing me to destruction. 1 Thessalonians 3:5, I'm getting ahead of myself. For this reason, when I could no longer endure it, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter had tempted you and our labor might be in vain. When I could no longer endure it, I went because I wanted to know your faith. Lest by no means that the tempter tempt you and you fall prey to it. I put you, this is what God's saying, I put you in the situation of testing. But the seducer is the one trying to destroy you in the test that I've given you. You see, you got to understand, when God comes in and he puts you in a trial, it is not seduction. Oh, thank you, Jesus. That would have been real bad. I was about to fall through the valley of Sorek. Who put this chair up here? Your Delilah self. Thank you, Jesus and Joshua. When he comes in and he brings me into temptation, he does not bring me into temptation to be seduced, to be destroyed. He brings me into a place of testing. And oh, by the way, this test is an open book test. And the reason we failed the test is because we never cracked the book. Never mind. So he puts me. Any good teacher will test you. Because it's not important enough for you to hear the lesson. You've got to know that I have hidden your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. If there's no word in me, it's a guarantee. It's an open book test. And he brings me, he tests me. This trial that you're enduring, this thing that you're facing, this struggle from what was to what can be, it's just a test. And a teacher never gives you a test that he hasn't or she hasn't prepared you for in advance. And the Bible says that he is the master teacher. So I have to believe, if I trust, that he would never put this test in front of me to succeed in if he wasn't already convinced he had already equipped me with the answers. For you see, the difference between God bringing a temptation, a trial into my life, and the enemy is God tests Satan traps. The objective of God is to test you. The objective of Satan is to trap you. Audacious prayer point number 3. God won't mislead us. He is not going to mislead you. Some trust in horses, and some trust in chariots, but we trust in the name of the Lord. For I believe, trust in the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not on my own understanding, but in all my ways I acknowledge you, because you are directing my path. You said in Isaiah that you would make their crooked paths straight. Oh, the Bible says that God would come down in the cool of the evenings and walk with Adam. He would walk with Adam in the cool of the day. It's very interesting to me that he would walk with Adam, which means Adam is leading the path and God has accompanied him. He would come down. He would condescend himself to walk with Adam. Adam, wherever you're going, I'm going with you, son. I just want to be with you. If you're going to the field, I'll go with the field. If you're going to the fruit, I'll go with you to the fruit. I'm going to come down and walk with you in the cool of the day. But the Bible says that Enoch walked with God until he no longer existed. The question is, who's leading? If he is the one leading you, you will no longer exist. And I just want us to understand something today, that when he's the one leading you, he will not mislead you at all. Even the valley of the shadow of death is not misleading you. Even your loneliness, even your struggle, even that job going away, if you trust that he's the one leading and guiding you, you can stay true to him, because what you're doing is you're walking according to the teacher in the middle of the test. James chapter 1, 2 and 3. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Say, this word trial is the same Greek word as temptation in Matthew 6:13. It's the same word. So when I read in Matthew 6:13, temptation, he's meaning trial, not seduction. So I'm not asking God to keep me from seduction. I'm asking him, look, if you're going to lead me into a test, I don't really want to be led into a test. Find me a kid who loves to be tested, and I'll find you a kid who needs to be tested. That was funny in my head, I guess. Watch this. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. And maybe why we're not so patient with our kids is because we refuse to take the test. Maybe we're not so patient in our marriages because we refuse to take the test. Maybe we're so impatient in our singleness is because we refuse to take the test. We're looking for the cliff notes, the cheat sheet. But I just want you to know there's no elevator here. It is the steps of a good man that are ordered by the Lord. Stop looking for that escalator. It is the steps. Take the stairs. That's good. Matthew chapter 4, verse number 1. Then Jesus, watch this, was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tested by the devil. Okay, hang with me. It was the Spirit that put him in the position to be seduced. It was not the Spirit that seduced him. It was the Spirit that put him in the position. And the tempter recognized the vulnerability of the moment. Because ain't nobody going to run away from God when everything is great. But when all hell's breaking loose, that's when the bottle looks really, really good. Well, what's the point of the test, Pastor? Well, let's look at Jesus. If the Spirit led him into the wilderness to be tempted, to be tested, he came back, Luke chapter 4, verse 14. Then Jesus returned in power. So the whole reason he went through the process was to be able to come back with power. The whole reason he allowed this circumstance to be in his life was because the Spirit knew on the other side is power beyond what you can even imagine. What are you saying to me? I'm saying that there's power on the other side of this pain. Don't give up. Do not grow weary in well-doing, for you will reap if you faint not. I'm so sick of this. Good. Good. Just don't quit. But you don't understand, Pastor. I'm afraid. That's great. Do it scared. Just keep going. Don't quit because you're afraid. My son and I, one of the things that we do is it is our objective to ride the top 10 roller coasters in America. It's our objective. This is what we're going to do. Ride the top 10 roller coasters in America. We're going to travel all over the country. We're going to ride the top 10 roller coasters in America. We've already hit three of the top 10 already. By the time he graduates high school, we are going to have ridden the top 10 roller coasters in America. Now, I want you to understand, my son loves it. He loves it. It is a thrill. But he has nothing to live for. His clothes are because I paid for them. His iPhone that he thinks is his, it's not his. The bill comes in my name every single month. You understand what I'm saying? The food in his belly is because I gave it to him. The piece of clothes, the bed he sleeps in. You understand what I'm saying? He ain't got nothing to live for. Go on up there 755,000 feet in the air. Drop right on your head if you want to. Spin like Superman. You can do all that. I'm 40. That's 20 times 2. You understand what I'm saying? And we get out. Let's go, son. Let's go, son. And then we start that climb. And contrary to Miley Cyrus, it ain't about the climb. I'm going. Lord Jesus, I look up to the hills from whence cometh my help. My help, I'm closer to you, Lord. Take me. Listen, if I'm going to die down there, take me in the spirit right here. I'm telling you, it's full of, I'm telling you, Satan created roller coasters. It's an act of the devil. It's an act of the devil. I'm excited by the time it's over with. Here's why. Because I'm more afraid of what I'll miss than what I'll have to experience. So I do it in spite of my fear because I'm more afraid of what I'll miss in experience with him than what I will have to endure. Do you understand what I'm saying? Here's what you have to believe. I have to believe that if God brings me to this test, then he has brought me to this test. He leads me to success, not failure. This congregation are full of educators. Full of educators. No functional teacher who is healthy gives a test to fail a kid. For the failure of the kid is not a failure of the kid alone, for it is a failure of the teacher and its ability to teach. Do you understand what I'm saying? There's no father, not a healthy one, that sets his child up for failure to make a point. Thank you, Lord. So if an earthly father would not give his son a stone for bread, how much more does the heavenly father want to put you in this test to succeed? Yeah, the temptation in your life is not there. I'm trying to stay away from deliverance with all of my ability. But I just want you to know the reason he makes a way of escape is because in the event you're about to fall prey to this temptation, this trial, he says, I'll give you an exit hatch. But I didn't put you into this situation to fall. I put you into this situation to win. You are going to be more than a conqueror. You're bigger than you think you are. You're better than you think you are. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon you, and I've anointed you for greatness. But you're never going to know you're great without the trial. How are you going to know you got it if you never get tested on it? Audacious prayer point number 4. This is the last one. God will lead us not into temptation. God will lead us according to what he knows. He's leading you according to what he knows. Not what you think. Now, that's hard for some of us because you are the smartest person you've ever met. You know, y'all can sit there and look at me like your mama don't love you if you want to. I know I'm telling the truth. Because I get critiqued every Sunday morning. Like you're the smartest person in the room. Cracked your book all week, but you're going to tell me, never mind. Yeah. Whew, I just went into bitterness, didn't I? Uproot the root of bitterness. You understand what I'm saying? I about went from roof to Mara. He is going to lead you according to what he knows. And the Bible says that he is the author and the finisher of your faith. Don't ask him to finish something he didn't write. And don't ask him to stop in the middle of his sentence. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. He is the omniscient, the omniscience, the all-knowing God of the universe. The Bible says in Jeremiah that God has declared the end of a thing from the very beginning. In other words, before he ever started you, he had already finished you first. He had already MapQuested, Google navigated your search engine, your pattern, from start to finish before you ever were a twinkle in your daddy's eye checking out your mama. He was already there, and he had already declared the end of your life from the very, he goes to the end to see what the completed work looks like, and then he goes and starts it. And he has declared the end of a thing from the very beginning. So when he leads us into our trials and into our tests, it is not in light of where you are, but in light of where you're gonna be. So I have to trust that in the middle of this, he's leading me on the knowledge he has, not on the knowledge I have. You know what I'm saying? Ooh, I'm about to throw. You understand what I'm saying? I have to trust it. I have to believe it, that he is leading me on his knowledge, not mine. So you ought to be really excited about that, because if God has started something in your life, you ought to recognize he wouldn't have started it until he finished it. So if he started healing you, he's already finished healing you. If he started delivering you, you're already delivered. If he started you, you understand what I'm saying? He's already done it from the end before he ever even started. Before he ever started. Before he ever even started. So watch this and I'm done. Job chapter number 1. Job chapter number 1. I have to trust that God is leading me on his knowledge, not my own. Some of you look at your situation as if you have stepped backwards, because you're looking at it from your knowledge. What is he doing? Job 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. Talking about angels. And Satan also came among them. Now this ain't my sermon, but I just want to stop right here to let you know that your tempter still has to get approval. That even your devil is God's devil. That there's not this big war between good and evil. It's not even close. That Satan still has to come get permission. And the Lord said to Satan, where are you coming from? Don't you hear El Shaddai, the blessed one, that mama in God? Where you been, boy? You passed your curfew. Where you been? I want to know. Can't you hear the 17-year-old Satan devil? I'm a grown man. You ain't going to tell me. I'll come in and go as I please. Uh-huh. You going to go right. I'm about to tell you where I'm going. I'm going right upside your head. That's where I'm going. So Satan answered the Lord, because he will give an account, and he has to. From going to and fro on the earth and from walking back and forth. He said, I've just been wandering. Next verse. Then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? That there's none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil. Now, I want you to understand this. Job is down there minding his own business. He is not a part of this conversation. He has no clue that this was God's idea. You hear what I'm saying? Job is living his life in his blessing, in his favor, in his prosperity, in his anointing. And God is up there setting him up to be tested. He has no idea the conversation that God has initiated. So Satan answered him and said, hey, does Job really fear you for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? There is a hedge of protection built about those who are walking according to the Lord that the enemy cannot penetrate. You have blessed the work of his hands and his possessions and have increased the land, but now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. Satan is saying, the only reason he serves you is because I can't get to him and he's got a whole lot of stuff. Because he's in your favor, he's got a lot of stuff, and the reason he worships you is because he's got a lot of stuff. But if you let me at him, he'll curse you. Listen to what God said. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power. Just don't lay a hand on him. I love another, I think it's the NIV or the NLT. It says, do not lay a finger on him. Don't even put your finger on him. You can go after his stuff. You can go after his family. You can go after his marriage. You can go after his children. You can go after his cattle. You can go after his barns. You can go after his house. But I'm telling you right now, do not put a finger on him. And we'll find out just how much he is for me versus stuff. This is all God's idea. This is not Satan trying to manipulate God to get at him. This is God saying, I know him. For men look on the outer appearance, but God looks at the heart. Oh, okay, I gotta hurry. And the reason is because God, you remember audacious point number four? God will lead you according to what he knows. So I want you to see this. Let's see. Help me. Go on. Oh, I'm sorry. Stay right there. Give me my desk. Give me my desk. Stand up right there, Miles. Yeah. Right there. Perfect. Yeah, that's good. So God says, none of the stuff means anything. But God said, I'm going to lead Job through a process because what he currently has, I'm about to multiply. But I'm not going to multiply what I want Job to have until I know that what he has is already mine anyway. So God's idea was to test Job in the now because he already knew the double portion that was waiting on him on the other side of the test. See, most of us approach this text, and the way we've heard it preached all of our lives is that because he was faithful in the test, he got a double reward, like it was God's idea after he passed the test. No. It was God's idea from the very beginning was to give him double what he currently, yes, he was blessed, but he was about to be doubly blessed. Yes, he had a great family, but he was about to have double the amount of favor. Yes, he had great favor, but he was about to have doubly the amount of favor. And God said, how I get him to the double the amount is I gotta have a test. But what God called a test, the enemy, come here, pick it up. Yeah. Called a trap. He said, if you let me trap him, he'll curse you and die. He'll die right in this snare. To your face, he'll cuss you. Peter couldn't even do that. But he said, if you let me get after his stuff, let me trap him. God saw it as a test. The enemy saw it as a trap. But I'm not walking according to the leading of the enemy. I'm walking according to the leading of the one who already knows what he already has for me. So what the enemy calls my seduction to destruction, the Lord says is a test, because on the other side, your eye has not seen, and your ear has not heard, and it's never even entered into your heart what I'm about to do for you on the other side of passing the test. Your level of trial is an indicator of God's confidence in you. You didn't hear what I said. The level of your trial is an indicator of God's confidence in you.
The level of the thing that he allows you to go through is a sign of the confidence he has. In other words, he didn't bring you to this test to fail. He brought you to this test to get beyond what you could even imagine. Are you hearing the words that are coming out of my mouth? You say,
1 Peter 1:7. So that the genuineness of your faith, more valuable than gold, which perishes through refined by fire, may result in praise and glory and honor, at the revelation of Jesus Christ. May be tried by fire. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control, because I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. He had no idea. That it may be tried by fire. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control, because I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Fire does two things. It burns up and it purifies.
That's right.
The same fire that can devour a house is the same fire that can purify the imperfections in gold. Same fire. It's not a special fire for purification, and it's not a special fire for destruction. It's the same fire. The same fire that can light a candle is the same fire that can destroy your house. Do you understand? It's fire. It's not certain types of fire. It's fire. Fire. It burns up and it purifies. In the same campfire, I can throw wood to be consumed and put gold that can be purified. And there are different degrees of intensity of that fire. But the components of the fire itself doesn't matter. The fire can purify, the fire can burn up. When someone lights a fire for purification and someone lights a fire for destruction to burn things up, when the fire is ignited, the fire does not know why the fire is there, because the fire doesn't have a mind of its own. So when the fire has been lit and ignited, it doesn't know if it's there for purification or destruction, it's just there to burn. The only difference between destruction and purification is the material that is placed in the fire. It's what is put in the fire that determines whether it's the fire for purification or the fire for destruction. I feel like I'm pulling you. You understand what I'm saying? I can build a fire right here in this room. And if I want to purify something, I can put boiling water over top of it and it can burn it away. And I can put a bunch of leaves on it and it can create a whole bunch of smoke. The fire does not determine what it is built for. It will burn if that's what's put in it, and it will purify if that's what's put in it. It doesn't matter to the fire what is in the fire, as long as the fire gets to do what it was created to do.
Yes, yes.
And the
determination of what the fire does is what the material is that is in the fire. So if my marriage is going through the fire, the question is, what is the material of your marriage? If your marriage is a bunch of chaos, your marriage is a bunch of papers, your marriage is a bunch of covenant contracts, and your marriage is not love, then guess what? When it goes through the fire, your marriage is going to be destroyed. But the fire was never meant for the marriage to be destroyed. The fire was meant to purify the marriage, to purify the sacredness of it, to purify the hearts of it, to purify the people of it. It all depends on the material you put in it. So I walk through my singleness, and I'm in the middle of the fire, the trial, the test. The question is, am I going, what is your singleness made of? What's it made of? If three Hebrew boys can stand in the middle of a furnace and see Jesus come in the middle of it, you can stand in the middle of your fire too. You understand what I'm saying? Oh, I love that. Oh, God, thank you, Holy Spirit. It burnt the ropes to set them free in the fire. They were bound before the fire, but because of the fire, they were set free. For whom the Son sets free is because of the fire. Jesus did not come in to set them free from their chains. He allowed the fire to do the release. I'm sweating down to my socks. The question is, are you sick in your body? I've watched this with my wife. Going through this season, I'm finding out real quick what she's made of. This test, beep, beep, beep. You know what happens every Panther game. This is the test. This is the test of the emergency broadcast system. This is only a test. In other words, this is not really what's going to happen to you. There is not some tornado that is going to destroy your home. There is not some hurricane that is going to drown and flood you. This is just a test. But the reason we put the test is to make sure in the event that calamity comes, that our ability to communicate is there. Oh my God, I feel the Holy Ghost. I just want somebody to know this morning. You're ready to give up. You're ready to give in. You're ready to throw in the towel. You're ready to just be consumed by the fire and let this thing destroy you and everything close to you. But I just came by to tell you on behalf of the Holy Ghost, man, this is just a test. My God, this is not a trap. This is for your success. Don't look at what it is. Look at what you're going to. This is only a test. I feel the Holy Ghost. This is just a test. It's just a test. But you let the tempter trap you into thinking this is what it is. The devil is a lie. You are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. You're blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed in your uprising and your downs. You're blessed coming in and you're blessed going out. The hand of the Lord is upon you. He has put the sovereign anointing of God over your life. You are anointed. This is just a test. You can't go to the next level without passing the test. Without passing the test. Some of you have been flunking this level for so long. And it's not because you haven't been taught the lesson. You're refusing to apply the principles. It's just a test. Lead us. Into a place where
where I can fail. Here's what the Holy Spirit said to me Friday before I left the office. He said this, he said, the issue is, I can communicate this effectively. The issue is, we are so focused on our temptation to fall to sin that we never perceive the tempting of the Spirit to win. We're so focused on what may go wrong that we never take the time to look through the trap to see what's going to go right. We're so afraid of blowing it. We endure the test so we don't blow it. So we live walking on eggshells, tiptoeing through the test, hoping that this isn't the landmine that traps me in. I remember growing up in school. I was an excellent tester. Excellent tester. So good at testing that I could study about 20 minutes before the test and handle my business. The problem is I was a terrible studier. In my attempt to be funny in class, I would never get the right material to pass the test. You hear what I'm saying? Okay, let me put it. In my attempt to be popular, I never got the right education to pass the test. I ran the risk of being cool and trapped. Accepted by man, but stuck at a level I was never meant to stay at. Some of us are so afraid . The disciples are sitting on a boat and the test has surrounded them. And what I love about this story is Jesus comes walking over the thing they're terrified of. He's walking on the thing they're afraid is going to kill them. He is above the thing that they think is going to take them down. The disciples are sitting there. They're holding on to a vessel that cannot sustain them. And Peter says, looking at a ghost, Lord. Now I know some of y'all are real spiritual. So you think he gets the microphone with his preacher shirt. Lord, bid thou meest to cometh, that thou mightest beeth with you on this watereth, and walketh in boldnesseth before thee. I don't believe that. I believe he's sitting there and that thing is freaking him out. He's like, Lord, loud, if that's you, you're on top of the thing about to take me under. Bid me to come. If it's you, tell me. Tell me and give me permission. You see, Jesus can defy gravity because he created it. He's above the law. That's why he can defy it. Peter, all the disciples had the opportunity, but Peter decided he wanted to walk in miracle territory. While the rest of the disciples watched a miracle, Peter got to walk in one. Do you want to watch miracles, or do you want to walk in one? Then I must pass this test. This test did not come to me to kill me. This test came to me to propel me to my next level. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you are protecting us.
You have just seen the Word of God, I pray, come alive. And I don't want to leave this moment, I didn't want to leave you leaving this video without a moment for you to maybe make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. It's real simple. All you have to do is ask Him to come into your life, believe that He is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and confess your need from Him and the fact that you've been far from Him. And today I pray that that would happen and take place in your life. But before you leave, I also wanted to do one thing that we do at the conclusion of every service, which is speak the Deuteronomy 1:11 blessing over your life. And I say, may the God of your fathers make you 1,000 times more than what you are and fulfill every promise that He has given you. We love you. God bless you. We hope you check out more videos. And if there's anything we can ever do, please email us at info@judahchurch.org.